India has many hidden stories within her lands. Scattered across the Indian countryside are the signs of a people whose origins are rooted deep in ancient times. From the beginning, the history of India has been shaped by its geography. The Indian Peninsula is a huge landmass with strong natural defenses. In the north, the east, and the west, there are great mountain ranges. In the center is the wild Deccan Plateau. It is to the north of this, in the fertile plains of the Indus and the Ganges, that we find the heart of ancient Indian civilization. Here, we find the earliest evidence of a nation thousands of years old.
Indian civilization is one of the oldest in the world. We know this for a fact that the ancient Indians were highly proficient in all fields of literature. Despite this fact, there is no rational explanation for their total lack of historical sense. Nobody ever thought of leaving anything for history. Whatever information that we can gather is basically in the forms of sacred books, which are part sacred and part social comment on the time.
It's useful and interesting look at India to see how things can happen in a different way. For example, in the early period, in the Bronze Age civilizations, you can see a very different model to the development of states to that which we know from Mesopotamia and Egypt. What people always say about India is that it's got this amazing ability to absorb external influences, foreign influences, and turn them into something uniquely Indian.
Up until the 1920s, archaeologists thought that the story of India began around 1500 BC, with the arrival of invaders from Central Asia, known as Aryans. But in 1922, archaeologists began to make some amazing discoveries in the valley of the river Indus. Over 100 sites have now been identified, with Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa the most famous.
Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa are, in a sense, really signposts with which we say this is where our history begins. Before they were discovered, people believed that the dawn of civilization in India started off with the Aryans. And of course, that was a convenient place to begin it off because the Aryans were probably from Europe. So it was reassuring for Englishmen and Germans who were working with linguistic studies to feel this common ethnic and linguistic affinity between what were at one time the great civilizations. What archaeologists have discovered today is that really Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa are just the tip of the iceberg. There are so many urban sites all the way from Afghanistan into the Gangetic Plain.
The people of this ancient civilization are known as the Harappan or Indus Valley civilization. By whatever name, they lived a sophisticated life. They were farmers who could breed cattle, goats, camels, pigs, and elephants. They grew wheat, barley, and cotton. They were skilled in metalwork and jewelry making, and they knew how to trade. At the heart of the port of Lothal was a magnificent dock. Here, cargo ships were loaded with Indus Valley products. Merchants would then sail to the Arabian Sea to trade with the peoples of Mesopotamia. Profits must have been substantial to support 100 cities. And it is the urban nature of Indus Valley life that is the most intriguing feature of these mysterious people. All the way up the Indus and for hundreds of miles along the coast, excavations have revealed cities all built to a similar pattern, with the capital city of Harappa the most magnificent so far discovered. To the west of Harappa was the citadel, an elevated area which contained the granaries and public baths. Below this, the streets were laid out in a grid arrangement, running roughly north-south and east-west. Shops and domestic homes lined these roads, and they were all built from brick. But it is the efficient system of drains and sewers that reveals just how sophisticated Indus life was.
In Harappa, like in other parts of the world, water does take on ritual importance, and this is not peculiar to Harappa. But what is quite interesting and radical is the very sophisticated level of waterworks, right from cisterns, from individual houses, that then go along narrower channels, brick-lined channels, along side lanes, which then go onto middle-sized channels on the secondary level streets, and then to main underground channels, which then went right along under the main streets and then spewed all the sewage and sullage outside the city wall onto the wider landscape or river structure, estuary or whatever.
Until the Roman Empire, nothing along the lines of the drainage system at Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro, for example, is known. The weights and measures which are used in trading, probably imagine in trading and commerce, are standardised and they're held to a very fine degree of accuracy as well. There's an enormous geographical coverage, 680,000 square kilometres, which is much bigger than Mesopotamia or all Egypt put together. The Indus Valley was a unique civilization, quite distinct from Mesopotamia and Egypt.
The language spoken by these people has not been deciphered, so there is not much that we can know about their social life. The best information that we can gather is by way of terracotta seals. We get to learn about their form of worship. There were several gods and goddesses that they worshipped. And highest on the pantheon of gods was a female goddess known as the Mother Goddess. They also believed in the importance of trees. And so the trees were very sacred symbols for them. They felt that the trees were inhabited by divine beings.
Around 2000 BC, the Indus Valley civilization started to decline. The second millennium BC saw the arrival of a new people in the Indus Valley, invaders from the north who would spread across the fertile lands of the Indian plains, the Aryans. These were tribal herdsmen, a race of nomadic warriors. The Aryans may or may not have been responsible for the demise of the Indus Valley people. Details of their early life remain obscure. There are no monuments or artifacts to give us a taste of their culture. But we do know that Aryan society was divided into three social classes: farmers, nobles, and priests. The priests were the holy men responsible for rituals such as animal sacrifice, which were the lifeblood of Vedic culture. These priests were also the curators of the religion of the people, bards of the beliefs and practices of India. This literature would eventually be written down as the Vedas.
These Vedas are in the form of several books, and less than a historical account, they are basically more sacred in writing, and they have a lot of social idea about those times. The Rig Veda, that is one particular book from the Vedas, is considered to be the oldest book in the world. And this gives us an insight into the life of the people.
There's no doubt that modern Hindus trace their origins, the origins of their religion, back to the Rig Veda, or the Vedas of about 1300 BC. In the Vedic period, we see a religion which we could describe as a sort of mystical naturalism, if you like, a mythical worldview in which a number of gods, principally Indra, but a number of other gods, seem to represent forces of nature to some degree. They're quite similar, in fact, to the early Greek pantheon. And the religious rites seem to revolve around sacrifice, largely. Sacrifice of horses and other animals. And using soma, this mysterious plant, which might have been some sort of drug.
Most of the religious ceremonies were conducted by women. For any important decision, women had to be consulted. This is possibly the period when the cow was considered a sacred symbol, because milk and its byproducts were the most important diets in their daily life.
At around the time of about 500 BC and thereabouts, the Upanishads were written. And at this time, we see a revival of civilization and urbanism in the Ganges Valley, and an increasingly sophisticated society. And it's clear from the Upanishads that there's an increasing concern with individual salvation, with more mythical and mystical problems, and with the difference between right and wrong. So entering into something that we might regard as closer to what we would call religion today, something with moral aspects.
One of the central messages of Hinduism is that life revolves in an endless cycle. According to the principle of samsara, death is followed by rebirth. But the nature of this rebirth is determined by the deeds of the individual. The path a person chooses in life directly affects the form in which they are reincarnated. A person who lives dutifully in accordance with the principle of karma can look forward to reincarnation in a human form. If, however, someone contradicts the principle, they can expect a far more lowly reincarnation. By around 500 BC, the basic principles of Hinduism were firmly established. These included the formal division of society into classes or castes. The lowest of these were the Sudra, the laborers. Then came the Vaishya, the peasants and merchants. Further up the caste ladder were the Kshatriya, the rulers and warriors. At the top of the social pyramid were the Brahmins, the teachers and priests. By the middle of the first millennium BC, this highest of castes also included ruling kings, known as Rajas.
The Brahmins had taken over the religious ceremonies which were being held in every household, which previously were conducted by women. They were making it more and more rigid to suit their means. And because of this rigidity, people were buckling under pressure, especially the lower castes, because they were looked down upon by the Brahmins. And this is the time when untouchables came into form. New schools of thought started emerging. And this is a period when Jainism and Buddhism came into form to break away from the rigidity of Hinduism.
India was now emerging as a recognizable nation of 16 autonomous states. In the 4th century, one of these, which Chandragupta would found as the Mauryan Empire, emerged as the dominant force. By 325 BC, the new king, Chandragupta Mauri, became the ruler of the state of Magadha. He soon proved himself an outstanding warrior. By 300 BC, he had conquered the valleys of the Indus and the Ganges and taken over the empire of Alexander the Great. The son and grandson of Chandragupta also proved to be great military leaders. By 262 BC, the Mauryan king Ashoka controlled almost the whole Indian peninsula. This was a large empire, and the Mauryans needed to maintain a tight control within its boundaries. A Greek observer described how an enormous army of 700,000 men policed the empire. And the Mauryan leaders were not afraid to use this army. However, the Mauryan age is better remembered for its wealth and culture. The sumptuous life of the imperial court was later recalled in some of the finest images of Indian art. The skills of the jeweler and the goldsmith were very much in demand. The age-old Indian love of exotic fabrics can also be seen.
The Mauryan Empire is crucial in its a fundamental period in Indian history. It's the first civilized period for which we have historical evidence, we have writing. And it's also because of Ashoka, one of the third ruler of the Mauryan Empire, and the edicts, the stone edicts that he wrote, which survive all over India today. And we also have a Greek ambassador who was actually present at the Mauryan court at Pataliputra, which was a capital, modern Patna in Bihar. Archaeological evidence has borne out some of the descriptions he gives us. It's quite likely that Pataliputra was the largest city in the world at that time.
The fact that Buddhism was postulating a moral code which was irrespective of any class, caste or gender barriers was in effect the basis of its popularity. While there would have been Hindu orthodoxy, this would have been, of course, restricted to the upper castes, whereas the common populace would have probably en masse converted to Buddhism in that this was a religion that gave them a major cultural underpinning. Until, of course, Buddhism becomes a state religion under Emperor Ashoka. Ashoka Maurya actually converts to Buddhism after most horrific battles on the plains of Kalinga, where he's deeply moved by human suffering at large. With the conversion of Buddhism as a state religion, it obviously traversed the barriers of certainly notions of the priestly class and the common populace, and therefore it had a much, much greater appeal, as indeed we see in all the Buddhist monuments that survive down to the present day are in fact initial edifices that were re-erected to some extent by Emperor Ashoka.
The Buddha himself took many of the ideas already formed by Hindu thought, Vedic thought, most important of which would be reincarnation and karma, responsibility for one's actions. So they have a very similar route. The most important of the four noble truths: life is suffering, He saw suffering around him. The second noble truth is that all suffering comes from ignorance and from desire. The third noble truth is that there is a way out of that, which is nirvana, a salvation, if you like, from this eternal cycle of suffering. And that the road to nirvana is the Eightfold Way, a path which he specified of right behavior, right thought, right meditation, right speech, right actions. So those beliefs, the Four Noble Truths and the beliefs that are associated with them, are distinct to Buddhism.
The embracing of Buddhist principles by King Ashoka led to a 30-year period of wise rule throughout his empire. Physical reminders of this remain today. Across the subcontinent, he ordered inscriptions to be carved in stone. Known as Ashoka's edicts, these were intended to be a permanent record of the emperor's enlightened thoughts and beliefs. From the 2nd century BC onwards, Buddhists had begun to carve artificial caves out of a steep hill near the city of Ajanta. The overall result was some 29 caves, of which the 19th may be the finest. Here, surrounded by the living rock, is a stupa mound. These were originally simple structures intended to house the holy relics of the Buddha. Inside, a huge figure of the Buddha, dramatically illuminated by the natural light entering through the gabled cave opening. It is easy to imagine the reaction of 19th century Europeans when they first discovered caves like this. There are few man-made creations as spiritually moving as this labor of faith. Sculpture is not the only art form visible at Ajanta. From 200 AD until 650 AD, the cave walls were covered with mural paintings. Fresco work, widely believed to be the greatest achievement of Indian visual art.
These are extremely important works for a host of reasons. They are the earliest surviving murals or examples of painting in the Indian tradition, and in themselves are therefore extremely important and valuable as archaeological evidence. What is extremely important about these in terms of their message is that they in fact illustrate the various former lives of the Buddha before he actually became the Buddha, which is to say, all the pre-Buddha states before he was actually enlightened and became the enlightened Buddha. He was born as a prince, and all his pre-Buddha states are essentially shown as somewhat royal depictions, the depiction of a prince adorned with all the state regalia, all the jewelry. You tend to see his elongated earlobes, which obviously held heavy royal earrings. The whole corpus of the pre-Buddha states, where he's still a prince, he's just at the verge of reaching enlightenment, he's at that transition.
The Mauryan age that inspired the Ajanta cave painters is the first of three great ages of Indian civilization. The dynasty did not survive the death of Ashoka in 232 BC for long. In the following centuries, a succession of invasions from the north led to long periods of political disunity. It was not until the 4th century AD that a powerful new dynasty emerged. These were the Guptas, a succession of monarchs who also hailed from the state of Magadha, and whose first great leader was also called Chandragupta. Under Chandragupta I and his successors, India again became a vast, unified land. For 150 years, the Guptas presided over a time of peace and prosperity. But the most lasting legacy of the Gupta dynasty was the development of a new system of decimal numbers. The Gupta age was also an important time for Indian religion. The period between the Mauryan and Gupta dynasties had seen a steady decline in the practice of Hinduism. During this period of disunity, it was Buddhism that proved most dynamic. But under the Guptas, Hinduism recovered and absorbed many features of the rival faith. In the end, Buddhism would become little more than a fringe religion in India. To this day, it is the complex Hindu beliefs that dominate the spiritual life of the Indian people.
In the resurgence of Hinduism in, say, the 4th century, 5th century AD, we can see a counter-reformation by the Brahmins, an attempt to win back believers, and to win back social control. And we can see elements of Buddhism coming into Hinduism, It has been argued that the very form of the Hindu temple is borrowed from Buddhism. But there are also important differences. Buddhism itself had been moving towards a more populist stance during the later years, looking to be attractive to perhaps simple village people who were interested in personal devotions and having deities to worship. And it's almost like the two religions are competing for the same electorate. They're competing for the same vote. They're both trying to offer gods or idols that people can recognize and understand and worship.
Ancient Indian is a very complex period. You have the coexistence of Hinduism, you have the coexistence of Buddhism, you have the coexistence probably of a lot of nature-centered cults. Vishnu, that becomes extremely important, is a much more subservient kind of god, a deity in the earlier Vedic corpus, wherein by the later Vedic period, he tends to become much, much more important. He in fact takes on the role of the sustainer in later Hinduism. Brahma tends to become much, much more important. And Rudra, who is later known as Shiva, who is the destroyer. So this essential kind of triangle of creator, sustainer, destroyer tends to emerge as the primary Hindu corpus, set of pantheons that are then developed upon in later centuries and in fact survive down to the present day.
The Gupta dynasty ultimately crumbled at the end of the 5th century. Again, invaders from the north were involved. These were the so-called White Huns, a race whose domination of India would be brief, but whose legacy lived on for centuries. By the end of the 6th century, many of the invaders' descendants had become fully assimilated into Indian society. These were the Rajputs, warrior families who established petty states in North and Central India. The Rajputs became committed to the Indian way of life, and the temples that they built remain the greatest of all Hindu monuments. Here at Khajuraho in the Madhya Pradesh region, the temples were constructed by a 10th century Rajput leader. Magnificent temples like this dominated 10th century India, both physically and spiritually. By this time, Buddhism had all but left the country to become established further east, in China, Korea, and especially in Japan. But now, a new threat to the Hindu faith was looming in the West, a young religion which already dominated territory from Spain to the Indian border. This was a very different kind of belief system to Hinduism. It was faith with one God that began to push towards India as early as the 8th century AD, Islam.
The Hindu civilization at this period had isolated themselves from the rest of the world. And the reason for this was that they felt that they were the most superior race. Their king, their country, and their knowledge was the best. So they discouraged any sea travel. And this was one reason that their defense from sea was very, very poor. Sometime in the early 8th century, the first invasion of India took place by the Muslim world. This was basically out of an extremely insignificant incident. An Arab ship leaving the coast of Sri Lanka and carrying goods and widows of tradesmen who had died in Sri Lanka was attacked by Indian pirates on the Arabian Sea. The governor of Iraq sent a letter of protest to the then ruler of Sindh for returning the goods and the women. Since the Indian ruler had no control over the sea pirates, he regretted his inability. The governor of Iraq saw this as an opportunity to strike, and this led to the first Muslim invasion of India.
By the beginning of the second millennium, Arab invaders had settled in the Indian territories of Sindh and Baluchistan. In the early 11th century, a Muslim warrior launched a series of terrifying raids in the lands of the Punjab. This was Mahmud Al-Ghazni, the most unpopular figure in Indian history. His fearsome incursions impoverished his Punjabi opponents, and soon another Indian territory had fallen to the forces of Islam.
The incursions of Mahmud of Ghazni were essentially centered around the amassment of booty to embellish his own capital in contemporary Uzbekistan, i.e. Samarkand. That was his sole objective and sole agenda. And for this purpose, planned his raids into the northwest and then through Delhi with great care. And in that sense, he did not prove to be a threat to the indigenous state of Islam or the pre-existing kind of Sultanate states.
The Muslims that were here, were a very diverse group of people. They had to be coalesced themselves into a kind of unity where Islam and being a Muslim in daily life meant something to them. The practitioners of Islam came in a variety of hues, a variety of interpretations of Islam present in North India itself. Now, when they were faced with the Hindus, I mean, now here that's a motley crowd as well. You have Hindus that might be Brahmins, but on the other hand, you have Hindus living just 200 meters away up in the forests. They may be regarded as Hindus today, but they were way beyond the pale of civilization for the Hindu Brahmins. They were what you would call today untouchables, but more likely aborigines, tribals.
But it was not until 1186 AD that Islam arrived in the Indian heartland. Under the leadership of Muhammad of Gur, Muslims from Turkey and Afghanistan swept across the country, slaughtering the forces of the Rajputs in bloody battles. By 1206, Muhammad had reached the Bay of Bengal, but in the same year he died. His successor, Qutb-ud-Din, inherited a substantial empire, which he decided to rule from a long-established Indian city. Qutb-ud-Din now became the Sultan of Delhi. In many ways, the city of Delhi typifies the Indian story as a whole. It is a heady mix of the ancient and the modern. One of the city's finest monuments proves that the Muslims wasted little time before making an architectural impact. This is the Qutb-Dinar, a tapering tower that is just one feature of a huge complex of mosques and other religious buildings. But it is this 260-foot high monument that is the first Sultan's most enduring achievement. Now a World Heritage Site, this building is an early example of a fusion of Islamic and Indian architecture.
If you look at it today, there could be no stronger iconoclastic statement. This was a mosque made out of 27 ruined temples. The people who constructed this mosque were all Hindu craftsmen. The presence of a Muslim architect or a Muslim master, perhaps telling the Hindu craftsmen, saying, "This is what I would like as a statement of my belief." And the Hindu craftsman saying, "Well, if you would like this as a statement of your belief, this is the manner my hand can craft it for you." You don't find any element of what art and architectural historians will call the Saracenic arch, the true arch, is absent. Instead, what you have is a corbelled arch, an interweaving of stone placed parallel to the ground. Now, this was a tradition of construction which was popular in the local neighborhood. This mosque was then destroyed by Muslims. So Qutb-ud-Din made the mosque, his successor renovated it. About 80 years down the road, another sultan came and he thought this mosque was not quite good enough. He renovated it once again. Each time the mosque was renovated, the old constructor was forgotten. And each sultan was again making the statement that this is in fact my mosque. Just like the Muslims who first came in said that the temples are not the places of worship, but my mosque is a place of worship. Succeeding Muslim sultans came and said, "The old mosque is not good enough, mine is much better."
Other sultans followed the first sultan's example, building more monuments and creating new capitals, each one trying to make his mark. Early in the 14th century, the Sultan Ghiyas-ud-Din Tughluq decided to move his capital from Delhi to a new location named after himself. This was Tughluqabad, a site half a mile square, enclosed by walls up to 90 feet high.
The moments of political stability that occurred in the medieval period occurred at times when the Hindu Raja, the Rana, and the Malik, or the Muslim Amir, the Muslim commander, combined. The technical superiority or the theoretical superiority, seniority, military worth of one would not be challenged by the other. This was mutually acceptable. And at the same time, that there would be commercial interchange between the two political realms. The two political realms would be autonomous up to as far as possible. They would cooperate in military ventures. They would not harbor enemies. There's a certain discourse that is created around this time period, a discourse of conquest, not just over the Hindus, but a discourse of conquest where the court, the Muslim, the court of the Sultan, hegemonizes the disparate groups of people who go by the name of being Islam, of being Muslim. Once the discourse gets to be created that they are one community under the umbrella and the protection of the Delhi Sultan, then you have, for the first time, the consolidation of an image of what it means to be a Muslim.
By this time, the assimilation of Indian and Hindu and Islamic motifs is already a tradition that is well established and is occurring at various scales. You see this at the level of the city, wherein you have a host of new cities, and certainly Tughlaqabad is an early Sultanate edifice at that level. So there's a whole urban tradition there, the nature of kind of laying out a mosque, a great Maidan-e Shah, a whole host of objects or edifices that dot the Islamic edifice, which indeed gives place to earlier pre-existing Hindu ones. So you have a great urban tradition.
Despite the strength of the structure, the new city was soon abandoned. The city had been built in response to a threat which had now become a reality. The threat came from an Asian warrior nation who had already conquered a huge area of the planet and who now sought to expand into the Indian heartland, the Mongols. At the end of the 14th century, the Mongols arrived in India with a vengeance. Under the leadership of Timerlane the Great, Mongol forces rode from the Punjab and sacked the city of Delhi. 100,000 may have been massacred during the enterprise. Delhi itself was looted of its treasure, its craftsmen and skilled workers carried off into slavery. But this booty was all Timerlane was interested in. In 1399, he withdrew from India, leaving the first of a series of weak sultans in charge. Ultimately, it was one of Timerlane's descendants who would make a far greater impact on the story of India. In the year 1526, he arrived with a new invasion force from the north. Though Turkish, this military leader claimed a direct bloodline from the Mongol leaders Timerlane and Genghis Khan. His name was Babur. His Mongol bloodline gave rise to the name of the dynasty that he founded, the third of the great ruling dynasties of India, the Mughals.
The Mughals were Muslims, but the early Mughals were not at all fanatical about this. They just happened to be Muslims, and they didn't really try to impose their religion on the population. In fact, they tried to integrate as much as possible. The great Mughal emperor Akbar, in fact, took wives from Hindu chiefs, and the children were then Muslim, but the idea was to integrate with the existing population. It's only with the Mughal emperor Aurangzeb in the late 17th century that we find less toleration of other religions in India. The problem with the Mughal empire was it never managed to unify the whole of India, and there were always continuing wars on the frontiers. The other problem under the Mughals, whenever a Mughal emperor died, there was a war of succession, and usually the most powerful son was the one who managed to gain power in the end and then tried to re-establish the rule.
The Mughals are the culmination, I think, of India's greatness. It's a strange thing that it was an Islamic dynasty and India is really predominantly a Hindu country. But this is one of the things of India. It's never simple. The Mughals did more in terms of organization and control of a large amount of Indian territory and a generation of enormous tax revenues. To create a massive standing army and a very sophisticated civilization than anybody. Akbar himself, the third Mughal emperor, instituted massive tax reforms, land reforms, to make sure that his state was able to collect tax. And he used that money to build the Mughal empire into what it became. The great Mughal was known around the world, Elizabethan England, Europe, widely respected as probably the wealthiest ruler anywhere on the surface of the planet.
The Mughal empire lasted until 1857. During that time, the territory under their control expanded to include virtually all of the Indian peninsula. Mughal rulers, such as the great Akbar, were not only brilliant commanders, but wise and generous rulers, like the Mauryans and the Guptas of the ancient past. Akbar especially encouraged a tolerant and fair system of government in his kingdom.
The farmers in India, they responded very quickly to the demand for products outside, and particularly cotton. They also began to grow new crops which came in originally brought by the Portuguese, and crops often seen as being very typically Indian, like chili. India was a land with massive population of artisans, particularly the handloom weavers, who were found all around the port cities of India, producing cotton cloth and other textiles such as silks. It was a very big transport trade in India, and this involved largely the carrying of goods on the backs of animals, particularly bullocks. The peasantry were very responsive to the needs of the market.
This was a culture that fused many different influences. In painting, the Mughal emperors sponsored artists to paint manuscripts depicting their own achievements. Images like these reveal the influence of old Persian art. But their sheer sense of realism has led many to detect the influence of the distant West. These vibrant paintings not only glorified the deeds of the Mughals, but also illustrated the Hindu epic literature which flourished under their rule.
The 18th century sees the emergence of strong regional powers. There are particularly groups in southern, western, and eastern India who emerge in the 18th century. In western India, we find the Marathas coming up, and this is a group who rebelled against Aurangzeb in the late 17th century, but established a very powerful state based on the city of Pune in western India. And they expanded over quite a large part of India in the course of the 18th century, and they could have in fact replaced the Mughals as the chief ruling group in India. The British really start to establish their rule in a serious way in the mid-18th century. Initially, the British were confined to just a few port cities. However, in the course of the 18th century, they managed to gradually expand their power, firstly in southern India, around Madras. Then, very crucially, in the 1750s, they gain control over Bengal. Then we see a gradual expansion during the course of the 18th century. The British allied with certain rulers against others. And after they had managed to defeat the main enemy, they often made an alliance or treaty with that ruler. But it's a long process, stretching over almost 100 years.
The Mughal Empire also saw a cultural fusion in the realm of music. The so-called Mughal style dates from the reign of the Emperor Aurangzeb. It is said that the emperor did not appreciate music, and so his own musicians decided to leave his employment. Their Muslim style now fused with the established Hindu folk music practiced away from the court. The hybrid style of music that resulted is still practiced and appreciated today. Contemporary northern Indian music is a continuing reminder of the fusion of Indian and Islamic traditions that took place under the Mughals. This fertile mixture of old and new also resulted in amazing achievements of architecture, and nowhere more so than at the city of Agra. Here, the Mughal emperor, Shah Jahan, commissioned the building of a fabulous tomb in memory of his wife, who died at the age of just 39. Her name was Mumtaz Mahal, and the monument that her husband constructed was one of the most amazing buildings ever seen on earth. It remains so today, a brilliant combination of the Hindu and Islamic traditions of India, the Taj Mahal. This is the most compelling monument to the power of romantic love. It is said that Shah Jahan and his beloved wife were never parted during their 18 years of marriage. When Mumtaz died, her husband was consumed with grief. But he soon resolved that his wife's body would rest in a fabulous tomb. 22 years later, in 1648, the Taj Mahal was completed. The labor of 20,000 men had been required.
The Taj Mahal epitomizes and is probably the living embodiment of Mughal achievement in India. The whole conception of the mausoleum is quite loaded and it evolves very interestingly in South Asia. In that, this is a monument of love. It's marvelously articulated in terms of it has all the tenets of the Islamic paradisiacal garden, at the head of which you have this great edifice. So again, as you progress into the monument from its outer enclosures, which are in red sandstone, the great gateway, and the two mosques that are on either side of it, on east and west of it, and then, of course, the main rather pearl-like setting of the monument itself, which is again sits adorned on magnificent plinth, the great domical chamber, and four corner minarets, which under normal circumstances would have been bastions adhering to the built form, but in this case have been given their own autonomy and done so very interestingly architecturally.
Sadly for Shah Jahan, there was a price to pay for this timeless expression of love. It is said that the Taj Mahal cost 32 million rupees to build. It is also said that such a price was too much even for a Mughal king. According to legend, Shah Jahan's lavish spending led to his overthrow by his son, Aurangzeb. The new ruler then imprisoned his father in Agra's Red Fort, a mile to the west of the Taj. For the last 8 years of his life, Shah Jahan remained confined. His only consolation was that his cell window looked out onto the monument that remains the greatest reminder of his rule and his love.
Everybody reacts to that building because of the supreme elegance, the fantastic color, the atmosphere about it, and the balance of its proportions. You don't need to understand it to realize that it's a very beautiful building. It's the culmination, in many ways, of more than a century of Mughal architecture in India, and especially the mausoleum. I think you could argue that by the time of Shah Jahan, who was deeply interested in architecture, we can see a completely new style. It's a new style, it's a fusion of the different traditions into one distinctive style, which really means that it's no longer important to try and separate out the Hindu elements or the Islamic elements, because it's become something on its own. It's become the Mughal style. And I think that the Taj Mahal really is the culmination of that process. It's the greatest monument, and it really is the monument in which the two styles are fused together to almost perfection.
It evolves out of traditions that are very indigenous to South Asian Islam, that of the mausolea and that of the pleasure garden, that are articulated in very South Asian terms. But more than that, it tends to become a pan-South Asian Islamic symbol of the time, of the 17th century, which in fact puts it at par with the Safavids in Iran and the Ottomans in Turkey. It tends to take on that great metropolitan kind of iconology of the survival and progress of Islam in India, interestingly on indigenous terms.
The Taj Mahal has outlived not only its creator, but also the Mughal dynasty, which began its decline 100 years later. India's earlier landmarks, such as the sophisticated cities of Harappa and Mohenjo-Daro, survived for 4,000 years hidden beneath the surface. No doubt, over time, India will yield up more of her lost treasures, each one with a story to tell.